You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at Twitter.com/options, StockTwits.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or via questions at TheOptionsInsider.com. Welcome to the Options Playbook, the program where we break down cutting-edge option strategies and explain how you can incorporate them into your own portfolio. Whether you're looking to grow your capital with some offensive maneuvers or protect your investments with defensive plays, you can find them all in the Options Playbook. The Options Playbook is brought to you by Ally Invest. Anything mentioned today is for educational purposes and is not a recommendation or advice. Options involve risk. Please refer to ally.com/invest/disclosures to review additional risks involved with trading options. Securities offered through Ally Invest Securities, LLC, member FINRA and SIPC. Now, let's open the playbook and get started.
All right, everybody. You know that music. You know what it means. It is time once again for Options Playbook Radio, the program where we break down all of the fun options plays you can use in your own portfolio. Maybe you want to swing for the fences a little bit on the speculative side. Maybe get some income. You want to go on offense? We got you covered. Maybe you're a little bit spooked, a little bit skittish. You want to figure out some ways to protect what you're sitting on. Got you covered there as well. My name is Mark Longo from theoptionsinsider.com, as well as, of course, from this network upon which you are enjoying this fine program right now. If you're just listening to OPR, A, we like you. B, you're missing out on a whole bunch of other stuff over there on the network. So head on over to wherever you find this program. Subscribe to the full network. You can get your options boot camp, your option block, volatility views, the advisor's option, TwiFo, all that good stuff and a lot more. A whole bunch of good stuff. We will keep you informed, educated, maybe a little bit enlightened and or entertained out there. We'll give you content pretty much every day. So a lot of stuff coming your way. A lot of you have been enjoying the network. If you're one of those people, we encourage you, leave a review on your platform of choice. Keep the influx of new folks discovering this program and discovering the network more important now than ever. And joining me to huddle up about your questions, once again, a little bonus huddle action for you folks. It's the usual host of this program, a.k.a. the options guy himself, Mr. Brian Overby, also the author of the Options Playbook, when he's not moonlighting over there as the cheap options analyst over there at Ally Invest. Mr. Overby, welcome back to your own program, sir.
It's always great to be back. And in our virtual huddle, we always practice social distancing here, got to admit. And with that said, yeah, it's great that we're able to do some back-to-back option questions here from our great fans and listeners. And I always appreciate this opportunity to give back to people that have been sending questions all along the way. So let's huddle up.
It's time to huddle up and answer questions about your favorite options plays. Submit your questions via Twitter.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or questions at TheOptionsInsider.com.
All right, let's get to it. A lot of you queued up here, ready to join us on the huddle. Let's kick things off, Brian, as we like to do these days. A little bit of love. These are tumultuous times. It's always nice to put some good feelings out into the ether again. So let's kick it off. Another 5-star review from iTunes, this time from Cubs Bleachers. Sounds like a local fellow here. He says, pow! Pow! I feel like the Batman TV show. Pow! Quick, interesting stock option strategy analysis with real market situations and data. Love the length, about 15 minutes. Brian, everybody's loving the length out there. It fits in with their busy schedule. He goes on to say, I sometimes listen to it twice to make sure I didn't miss important information. Well, there you go, Brian. More iTunes love coming at you. What do you have to say here for your pal, Mr. Cubs Bleachers?
Well, I love the fact that that he listens to it twice overall. I think that's good, clean fun, and try to do my best. One of the big things about Options Playbook Radio is that we try to address all the different strategies. So we're specifically just looking for situations where this one strategy might apply versus the other, and that's what makes the show kind of fun.
Makes it fun indeed. If you have similar feelings to what Cubs Bleachers is feeling over there, make sure you head on to your platform of choice. Could be iTunes, could be YouTube. A lot of you liking that platform over there. Other ones we'll see later on the show, weird esoteric ones like Podbean. A lot of you liking those as well. Doesn't matter where you get it, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, leave a review there so people can continue to discover this program. All right, next up, Brian, we got an interesting one. Comes from Tony. Tony Kyle, he's been waiting a while for his answer here. He sent this in a little while ago, I recall. He says, what are the panelists' thoughts on annuities? Sales appear to be soaring. What does this mean for the options market? Is this really just a way to get indirect derivatives exposure without diving into the deep end? Does this hurt options volume and growth? You know, since we're talking options volume, Brian, I'm going to bump up this question from Ellie here as well, because it's kind of related. She writes in and says, hello there. Loving the show, I have to admit that the recent volatility, especially in March and again in recent weeks, has me a little bit worried. So I'm back in cash. Am I just a low-risk trader, or are more people doing this? Are you seeing a hit in the options market as a result? Thank you, Brian, for putting out this program and educating noobs like me. You're no noob, Ellie. You're listening to this show, so that means you already have a head start across all of the other actual noobs out there. Since Ellie and, what was it, Tony, both want to know if the options market's taking a hit for different reasons, one for volatility, one for annuity sales, the short answer to both of you is no. Hot off the presses, as of right before showtime, OCC just put out their numbers for June. They are official, and I think you could safely say that the volume numbers in the options market blow in the doors off of it. June total volume was 693 million contracts. It's the highest ever in the entire history of the options market, up nearly 81% from June of last year, blew away the previous record of 670 million, which was set just a few months ago. Back when? Oh, in March of this year. So crazy times out here from an overall volume perspective. So all of you out there who are thinking maybe there's too much vol, and that can happen. You know, if March had persisted in terms of we didn't see this V-shaped correction, if instead we saw continued sell-offs, that could be where vol gets to be a little bit too much of a good thing. We were threatening an 80-plus handle there in VIX land. That could spook a lot of people. But we didn't. We saw the return of that and vol retreating a bit. And a little bit of vol is good. Too much can be too much. We're not quite at that too much level, apparently, because volume is still crushing it. So, Brian, interesting stuff. First off, Tony wants to know, what are your thoughts on annuities? Are they really just an indirect way to get derivatives exposure? And then Ellie wants to know, whether it's impacting volume. Maybe you could chime in with a little bit of some nuggets if you're seeing anything interesting volume-wise over there at Ally as well. Feel free there, Brian. A little bit of a twofer for you.
Well, yeah, our volume overall has increased, much like you see happening on the Chicago Board Options Exchange. So volume in the options world across the board and almost all the brokerage firms is up. It's obviously they're the ones that are sending the orders down to the floor. I do like that. I did know that in March they had the set that high, 670 million contracts overall. But I did not know that they just beat that record. And I love that I loved your reference all the way back in March. But I think the biggest reason here why you're seeing a lot of this is people are going to the options market for protection, and increase implied volatilities overall usually lead to more option volume in general. So the VIX index has finally came back down today below 30 for the first time in a while since actually the big run up that we had on the attempt at our V-shaped recovery. So today we actually see the VIX index is trading south of 30% implied volatility right now. But when I see the VIX run up, that usually means volumes are going to follow. And part of the reason why the VIX is running up and why implied volatility is running up is a lot of people are going to the options markets and trying to find some protection. They're trying to find a quick and easy, quote unquote, solution to try to protect themselves, usually to the downside overall, but not always necessarily. Some people might be trying to speculate on the upside, but in general, that's normally the case. Now, as far as annuities are concerned, I've actually never been asked that question before. I've never really thought about annuities taking away from the option volume overall. If it's an indirect way to get derivatives exposure, I mean, an annuity can be almost anything based on, it's all based off of how they want to set it up. I don't think people that are annuity traders are really, they're really stealing them from the options marketplace, because in general, if they're trading options, they're probably not that interested in annuities. But I'll let you kind of join in with me here, Mark. What are your ideas on annuities and overall volume?
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of folks looking out to the annuity space for exactly the reason you just described, which is they could pretty much contain anything. And I think Tony is right that a lot of them do have some sort of derivatives components. That's how they're achieving their peg, or maybe it is some sort of levered return component, whatever it is as part of this. There's different types. There's variables, index. He includes a link to an article from ThinkAdvisor that shows that sales are soaring for variable indexed annuities out there. I'd much prefer people to go out there and trade listed products like a SPY or an SPX or a NASDAQ, whatever index floats your boat, and then trade options around those products, because then you could do it directly. You know exactly what you have in your portfolio. There's no weird hidden fees. And we've seen what's happened just in the last few months. Listen, let's go back to March and see how a lot of these Franken products, including the annuities, we saw a lot of levered ETPs go the way of the dodo. I'm guessing a lot of annuities did something similar out there. These are Franken products at the end of the day, and you're kind of getting what you pay for. If you construct it yourself, if you know exactly what you have in it, there's no surprises. There's a ton of surprises, surprise fees. I don't think you're going to find anyone on our network who's going to say, hey, go out and dive into the annuity world rather than trade a listed option contract on a listed underlying that you understand what's in it. You understand the components. You can look on any options chain, see the volume, the volatility. These annuities, they're abstract. They're opaque. I definitely would prefer to see a lot of you heading in. And it seems like, at least short answer to your question, no, they're not really impacting options volume, because yet another exploding month here for the options market. Speaking of the love for the show, Brian, that's also exploding. Coming in from YouTube, I mentioned a lot of you guys liking it on YouTube. Now, some of you, I forgot who it was, requested playlists on YouTube. We have set that up. So now you could see, if you want to go and listen to OPR playlists on our YouTube channel, you can do just that. If you want to get everything else out of there, just focus on Brian's smooth, dulcet tones. You can do just that. We have it for other shows as well, and it should automatically update all that stuff. Stevens, he commented on, what is it, episode 318, our Skip Strike Butterfly in United Airlines. He says he loved it. Well, there you go, you Stevens. Glad you liked it. We love you guys are listening. More and more coming at us via the YouTube. Coming at us via a lot of interesting channels. That's what makes this kind of fun. Like this next one, I wanted to feature this on the show just because I didn't even realize we had such an extensive community of joining our content on Podbean. But clearly we do, including this user, Iceman. Brian, he chimed in on the previous episode. He said episode 317, which was piling into airline downgrades with your Jets put spreads. He said he couldn't find the July 19 puts and July 15 puts expiring on the 10th. At least in the Yahoo options chain. He went there. I encourage you, Iceman, go to your broker, because the Yahoo chain is sometimes a little bit dubious out there. But that kind of got me thinking, Brian, too. I was like, Podbean, I'm barely even familiar with its existence. Let me go check out what's going on. Sure enough, a lot of people are enjoying this program and indeed our network over there on Podbean. Thousands of downloads and streams and subscribes going on over there. So if you're liking what we have over there on Podbean, we have gone in there now and claimed all of our shows. And some of these outlets, they just scrape popular podcasts and they display them in their platform so they can have more content for their users. But they don't really contact us and let us know. So we went and made them all official now, so we can see when comments like this come in, we could see it and we could reference it and also keep track of what's going on over there. So if you like it on Podbean, keep it up. We don't care where you get the shows, as long as you're listening. Like the other previous commenter said, listens to it twice if you want to do that too. We wouldn't hold it against you. But Brian, you have any thoughts on your Jets puts not showing up, A, in the Yahoo chains, which are sometimes dubious, and then B, the explosion of interest in the show on all these alternate outlets outside of iTunes, sir?
Well, I'm just going to, yeah, I think you said it well as far as the explosion on the Podbean. On the, it's called Podbean? Am I saying that right? That doesn't really roll off the tongue that well, does it? and then I love that you love it, Stevens. The Skip Strike Butterfly and UAL, it was an interesting one. And we did, it was so interesting that we did a rinse and repeat on episode 319. And instead of a Skip Strike, we talked about a ratio, which is a very similar evil stepchild to the Skip Strike Butterfly overall. So thanks for the comments. Keep them coming. And it's just, it's great to know that we have some feelers that are just kind of weaving their way through the crevasses of the option trading world.
Yes. So yeah, if you're having problems finding a particular option contract, again, go to your broker's probably a more reliable source. Or if you have to go to like an OCC or something, you can do that too. Let's go out to LE59. They say, hey, Brian, what are people trading in their options accounts at Ally these days? Keep the shows coming, please. Thank you for reading this. Well, you're welcome there, Mr. and Mrs. LE59. Brian, interesting question. Obviously, we just mentioned a few minutes ago, these are hot times in the world of options. People are trading a whole bunch of stuff. What are they up to over there in Ally land these days?
Well, in the options world, it might be easier to tell you what they're not trading. One of the biggest things about the volatile times that has came in, and this is probably the biggest question that we've had, all of obviously the NASDAQ stocks have been getting a lot of volume, a lot of play, the FANG stocks in general. But you know what? They do in non-volatile times also. But one of the biggest things about the volatile times is understanding the width of the bid-ask spreads and trading these option contracts, because even though the liquidity is there, the bid-ask spreads have a tendency to widen overall. So we are seeing the same underlyings lead the way in the volume, i.e. the FANG stocks, anything that's been trading in the NASDAQ overall, and obviously the airlines, people speculating on some of the travel stocks, that has also increased in volume overall. So they're kind of following the volatility, but you always want to be aware that when you're doing that, when I see questions like this, you want to be aware that trading in these volatile times, you want to pay a lot of attention to the width between the bid-ask spreads and working your orders. And you don't want to just put an order in there and just let it sit and, you know, hope it fills overall. You really want to try to work your orders a little bit more and pay a little bit more attention in these times.
Well, Brian, I'm caught in a catch-22 here because people like the short length of the show, but they also send in a lot of questions. I want to make sure they don't feel left out. So let's see if we can squeeze in one more here. This comes from Tells with a Z. Tells with a Z says, hey, Brian, I love your podcast. I've been lurking on a popular internet message board for options trading, and I've seen a lot of posts promoting the wheel strategy. He puts that in quotes there, the wheel. What are your thoughts on this strategy? Is it really the key to riches, like some seem to think? I hope you read my question on the air. Well, we did there, Tells, so now you are famous and or infamous. You can share this on whatever popular internet message board you are lurking on. The wheel, if you're not familiar, listeners, this strategy has a bunch of different names. Our friends over there, Mr. Uncle Mike and the folks at RCM and St. Charles Wealth, they like to call it the triple income strategy. But either way, it usually has multiple legs to it. It starts off typically selling a put on a stock or an underlying that you don't mind acquiring at that particular strike price. And then if the stock drops below the strike, that's where the wheel kicks in. Now you get assigned the stock. Now you have a stock position. What do you do with it? Well, you turn around and you wheel out of it, hence the title. You sell a covered call against it. And the plan, at least, is to make some income on the put, then have the stock come your way, hopefully make a little bit of appreciation on that stock position while you hold it, and then at some predetermined time when you want to write that covered call, you sell that strike, and you appreciate all the way to that strike, and you make money there. So that's why they call it the triple income. I've always given a little bit of a hard time on that because I don't think all three legs of those are going to be making money at the same time. But still, it's an interesting strategy, and it certainly is an intriguing one for people who are looking for some opportunities to harvest a little bit of the old risk premium from a particular name that maybe they don't want to hold in their portfolio for an extended period of time. Brian, A, are you familiar with the wheel? B, do you have a funky name for it like Fig Leaf that I'm not aware of? And then C, as Tells wants to know, is it really the key to riches like some seem to think?
Well, to feed off of the fig leaf, like you said, not all the listeners might know exactly what the fig leaf is, but we've done some Option Playbook Radio, Option Playbook Radio shows based on the fig leaf. And all that was a strategy that was very popular that I decided to give a name to. And I feel like this is the same thing with the wheel strategy, in that it, one of the more popular strategies overall is to use options to enhance a stock portfolio. So there are many people that will trade options that have never bought an option contract overall. They own stock. They sell covered calls against it. They want to buy more. They sell protective puts against that position. This is just putting an actual name to this strategy overall called the wheel strategy. But all you're really doing is you're trying to generate income on stock that you might own. So if I sell a put, I'm saying I really want to buy some stock. If I sell a call, I'm saying I wouldn't mind selling that stock that I just bought. And the big deal about the wheel strategy overall, it's been, you know, it's been around forever. And a lot of people that do it, or that kind of go down this road of selling puts and selling puts to buy and selling calls to get rid of, have a tendency to kind of stay in that world. You're not necessarily looking for higher returns than what the market will do, but you're bringing income above and beyond dividends. Now, in some cases, it's going to outperform, and in some cases, it's not going to outperform, but it's a systematic way to approach your stock trading and enhance it with options. So the fact that we call it that somebody is calling it the wheel strategy overall, it just means that they're putting a simple name to a strategy that's been done over time, which is really relative to the fig leaf that Mark mentioned. And you can check that out at optionsplaybook.com, the fig leaf, and where that name came from. That actually came from our community inside our own our old company, our old blogging community that we had overall.
All right. That music means we've come to the end. You know, Brian, it is fascinating, though, to see the trends that emerge in the option space. And for a while there, a few years back, everyone was all hot about iron condors. Apparently, at least according to Tells on his message boards and others, it does seem like the wheel is a little bit in favor right now. Of course, over the last month and change, when we saw this aggressive V-shaped recovery, maybe the wheel wasn't the one you wanted to have on, unless, of course, you just decided to forego the covered call leg and held on to your stock. In that case, it could have worked out all right. But yeah, it's an interesting strategy. Like any strategy, it has its moments where it performs better, performs worse. But it has a lot of use case, and it's pretty simple for people to wrap their heads around, which is probably why it's getting a lot of play on the various message boards out there. Speaking of playtime, Brian, we're kind of up against it. We are out of ours for the rest of this show. But if folks are intrigued, they want to join Tells and all the rest over here who chimed in on the show today, or maybe they want to reach out to you in between episodes with your questions, where should they go? What should they do?
Well, I'm actually going to toss a little nuance into the ending here, and that you can always email me at theoptionsguy@invest.ally.com, but I've started tweeting more, so it'd be great if you'd start following me on Twitter. Handle is Brian Overby. You can't get much simpler than that. So please follow me on Twitter and email me at theoptionsguy@invest.ally.com. Thanks for listening. Thanks for hosting, Mark. We'll be back same time, same place next week. We'll actually get back into some more option strategies next week. Until then, may all the options you bought finish in the money and all the ones you sold finish out.
The Options Playbook is brought to you by Ally Invest. Anything mentioned today is for educational purposes and is not a recommendation or advice. Options involve risk. Please refer to ally.com/invest/disclosures to review additional risks involved with trading options. Securities offered through Ally Invest Securities, LLC, member FINRA and SIPC. You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's MIXLR.com/options-insider.
Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at twitter.com/options, stocktwits.com/options, facebook.com/theoptionsinsider, or via questions@theoptionsinsider.com.